beste leden, chers membres. Welcome at the fourth session of our Home of Governance Talks. During this turbulent period of, again, increased strict measure issued to the COVID-19 evolution, we hope to stay connected to you, our member community, by offering you high-quality content, inspiring services and debates, as well as by facilitating our members to exchange views on topical issues, also by this digital mean. Today, I'm very honored to be able to welcome Professor Dr. Kathleen de Stobbelaere. She is full professor and partner in leadership and coaching at the Vlerick Business School. She leads the Center for Adaptive Organizations, a center that aims to support organizations in dealing flexible with an ever-changing environment. Her specific areas of expertise include inclusive leadership, coaching, and building a feedback climate. She is also a board member, but recently the spotlight turned to her as the co-author of the excellent book Making Your Way, if you have not seen it in the press already. I know Kathleen for many years, and as well as a well-respected expert in the field of leadership, and I know her as having a sharp eye and a very human approach. The ideal guest to discuss the theme leadership, and in particular, the link or the correlation or relationship between governance, leadership, and resilience. Kathleen, I'm aware that of the many invitations that you receive lately, and I'm very, very thankful that you made some free time in your busy agenda to share your views with our members of Guberna, and finding the time to have this exchange. Kathleen, in preparation of this meeting, told me that she really prefers to also interact with you. So we would like to raise a question already to you, but may I kindly ask, as this is not a webinar, but a Zoom meeting in its format, that you send your questions by in the chat, and so that we don't disturb the meeting as such. And the key, and what we would like to ask you is, what is really your top of mind key question that you would like to see tackled by Kathleen in this privileged setting? But to kick off the debate, let's start by framing the notion of leadership in the right context. So, Kathleen, we heard a lot about leadership lately in different contexts, but what does it really mean for you in this turbulent times?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, I think it's good that you ask it to link it to this specific context. And by the way, it's also a pleasure from my side to be here today. As you can see, I have a tendency to jump in immediately, so you will need to stop me every now and then. But I'm glad that you link it to the context today, because I think that that's what I would say is really key about leadership. We really need to avoid that it becomes something dogmatic. And I think a million-dollar question I'm always asked is, what is leadership? And then I would say, well, I always use this metaphor of Warren Bennis, who always said, you can compare it with the horrible snowman. Everybody has seen its footsteps, but nobody has ever seen the real thing. And I think it's really good that we don't have a clear definition of what leadership is, because else it would become something very dogmatic. What works in one context will certainly not work in another one. If we look at today's context, I think we will all agree it's complex, it's turbulent, it's about constant change. And I would say today we can even add the word crisis a little bit to the cocktail. And I think a very big pitfall I see there is that when I look at the debates I hear about leadership today is the pitfall that people might resort into this idea that, oh, it's more of a crisis situation. So that requires unity in command and a command and control approach. And especially also because that is what we see that people also seem to look for. So they feel anxious. So they're looking for these strong leaders who have all the answers. We even see that in the political domain, I would say. But we also know that this is a huge pitfall in the sense that such strong figures, they often create a false sense of security, because if there's one thing we know for sure about a context like this one, is that it's so complex that I would even say it's not only about COVID, it's also about digitization. A lot of the challenge we have today in society, I'm also talking about climate change, they're so complex that one individual will not have all the answers, and it really requires a collaborative approach and really working together, having this diverse input. But for one reason or the other, we seem to think that, oh, it's a crisis, so we need this one person taking the lead and being the answers to all of our questions. And I already see some questions coming in, so that's also an interesting, I see some interesting questions already in the chat box. So let me know when you want to focus on that one, Abby.
Yes, but before turning to the chat, you already touched upon the trend of maybe sweeping a little bit away from the command and control approach mm-hmm. That we are used at in previous times. Mm-hmm. What other trends do you notice in leadership?
Well, I would very much link it, I would say, to what I also see in our economy. We've seen some huge shifts, economic shifts, going from more of a product economy, thinking, if you think about Nike, what did they produce? Shoes. Then we saw this big shift towards a more service-oriented economy. Also these producers thinking about what are the services we can build around our products. We saw that also, for example, in the financial industry, previously the product was a loan. Today, in this shift towards a service economy, we had all kinds of apps that were built around that, that also enhanced our customer experience. Today, we see this new shift towards what we call more the platform economy, really ecosystems, companies working together very organically, very often, thinking, for example, about banks, even working together with competitors to again also maybe be competitive in this very turbulent environment where basically your competition can come from anywhere. So companies that were previously big competitors today start working together in an ecosystem to stay competitive in that environment. And of course, if you look at that economic reality, this also, of course, leads to important shifts in leadership, because in a product environment, your competitors are pretty clear. If you make shoes, your competitors, they're other shoemakers. Of course, in a service environment, that becomes already a bit more complex. In an ecosystem environment, that becomes incredibly complex. To give you one example, I was a few months ago talking to a CEO from a temp agency, where in the past it was very clear, oh, my competitors, they're other temp agencies. Then it became the LinkedIn's. Today, this person is worried about dating sites because these companies, they build algorithms that connect people with other people. Well, these same algorithms, you can actually use them to also match people with companies. So in that environment, of course, your competition is much less straightforward. And that, of course, requires a completely different leadership approach. If your competition is simple, this unity and command will help you and will be probably the most efficient approach. But in such a complex environment, you will need to collaborate. You will need to also be able to define a purpose that is maybe even bigger than your own company and work together with your ecosystem to achieve that bigger goal, which also, of course, requires putting aside some of your own priorities sometimes to really focus first on that bigger picture. Yeah.
This links very well to the question that we received from Catherine Delange. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Catherine, who is asking, do you think leadership is embedded in a person's DNA? Yeah. You have it or you don't have it? Or do you think you can learn to become an inspiring leader or the more collaborative leader as you are pleading for?
I must say I'm really, really grateful for this question, and I actually sneakily hoped that it would come up because I think for one reason or the other, I do see that this DNA thinking is something I see still very much in companies. Having a bit this stereotypical image of, oh, you have the haves and you don't, you have the have-nots. There's people who have won this lottery of the leadership DNA, and then there's people who are a bit less fortunate and have not won that lottery. But actually, if we look at research, so it's not only me thinking this, but it's also research showing this, we actually know that this is a stereotype and that we that for every, for example, extroverted leader like a Steve Jobs or an Elon Musk, you also have an introverted CEO. But still, we keep on having this stereotypical image of what a leader should look like. Maybe it's also because these are the leaders we typically see a bit more appearing in the press. But I do think a lot of leadership is, one, contextual, but also it can be developed. And I would say if there's one thing I think all leaders should do, it is developing and constantly developing themselves, reinventing themselves. And in that sense, I think it's even a bit tricky. I see some leaders also maybe misusing the word authenticity to not develop themselves and saying, yeah, but that's who I am. But we also know that someone's personality, it's formed around the age of 8. So if you say, well, that's not me, I cannot do that, you're also basically saying I haven't evolved since I was 8, which is a bit tricky because in our companies, especially in this turbulent environment, we do expect that people change and that they come along with us and that they're willing to embrace change. But if we don't role model that and we stick to our genetic thinking around leadership, that's of course a bit of an then you lose a bit of credibility as a leader, I would say. Huh? Does that make sense?
Yes,
of course. That question.
We are still welcoming your interaction and your question. So I have another question, Kathleen, coming from Mr. François Xavier Securis. Excuse me if I pronounce his name not correctly. Mm-hmm. Don't you think that single-threaded and steward leadership is rather required in this context?
Yeah. So I assume, because it's not always clear, I hope I interpret the question right. So what I think François Xavier is asking here is, don't we need unity in command? So first of all, I think this can work in a simple crisis. But in a crisis that has a lot of layers, and especially also a crisis that is enduring, this is actually risky. Especially also, I would say, in right now, the specific characteristics of this crisis is it's a health crisis. So even that could be risky if you depend on one or only a few individuals at the top. And I always relate that to there. At a certain moment, we had this crisis Shell. They had this huge oil spill in the US. And if there's one thing we can learn from how they dealt with that crisis is the crisis management team, it rotated. So it was never the same people. And even though you had one crisis manager, let's say, he went home every day at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Not because he said, I don't want to do it or I'm lazy or whatever, but to make it really clear, we can't rely on single individuals in a situation like this, because it's too complex to really depend on it, on single individuals. But also, given that it is so complex, if your competitor, if you're in a temp agency and your competitor is really a dating site, well, it could also be 20 or 30 other contexts where this competition comes from. So you need all intelligence around the table. And of course, I see a lot of extremely intelligent people at the top of organizations, but even that individual intelligence alone won't suffice to address some of the huge societal challenges we have ahead of us. One being, for example, climate change, that will, per definition, require collaboration. So in that sense, I would really want to make a distinction between what I would call a simple shock event versus an enduring situation and enduring turbulence that is so complex as the complexity we see today. So I would agree if François-Xavier was referring to a product environment, but I would not agree when we talk about more the service context and the platform economy there. I would say rather the opposite. It will create a false sense of security for sure.
Thank you, Kathleen. Let's turn to the board of directors and bring the leadership within the board context. Mm-hmm. You're also a board member, so you are definitely aware of what is written in our codes on corporate governance, where it is clearly mentioned, especially then in the code 2020, where is a renewed emphasis and attention for leadership, that it's in order to strive for the sustainable value creation at the board should be establishing effective, responsible and ethical leadership. Mm-hmm. What does this mean for you in from a leadership perspective?
First of all, I can of course only applaud this increased emphasis on leadership, and especially the emphasis also on responsible and ethical leadership, which I would say is the one I would like to focus on a bit, because we also know that in let's say calm moments, it's easy to make ethical decisions, but we do know that also in times of turbulence we kind of easily lose track of our moral compass, but actually we also know that in times of crisis it is a key differentiator. We even have research showing that you could compare it a bit with a lighthouse, this ethical leadership or this moral compass, in the sense that in a calm ocean, you know, it won't make that much of a difference. But when your ocean is very, very turbulent, that's when you need that lighthouse. That's when you really need that moral compass the most. And we even see this translated in financial performance of companies. So those companies who do emphasize that a lot in times of turbulence, but also in calm periods, that they do also see a benefit from that in their financial performance. Now, what I do want to add to that is I also think it's important that we develop a fine-mazed view of what ethical leadership means in today's context, and that we need to make some of the let's say ethical dilemmas really explicit. So think about ethics in a digitized world, for example. We have the car industry, and if we look at digitization there, cars in the future will have to make some really difficult decisions, in the sense that when a crash is near, should they save the life of one person or five people? Should they save the life of one someone, a child or a pregnant woman? So these are all types of ethical dilemmas that are not so far away, I would say, and that we really need to make explicit, because of course it's humans who will program these devices, and also humans, we know, bring their biases into this, and I see this in many domains. I see this also in HR, for example, when we would use facial recognition, for example, to hire candidates. We, of course, don't want this to be biased. And if we know that today, a lot of the people programming these devices are unfortunately still male engineers, it's of course also going to influence the impact that this will have. And I'm not saying that diversity there is the only answer, but I do think that ethical leadership and then really making these dilemmas very explicit will be really, really crucial for the years to come. So I'm very pleased that I think it's very visionary to have that in the code of governance.
Do you see in this context with this making these dilemmas more explicit and being aware of the moral compass in decision making, do you see a specific role for the chairman as the leader of the board?
Well, I would say I see a role not only for the chairman, for the entire board to put these questions on the table, to also bring this external perspective and to challenge, I would say, the company in seeing this reality. Because when you're focused on the business as usual, and hopefully, of course, the top management team would also be thinking about these things. But as a board, I think it's really important to also put those things on the table. And to not go in the pitfall, maybe also especially in times of turbulence, and we might be a bit more concerned about numbers and really have a very close look at those numbers. But it's about long-term competitiveness. And then, of course, your strategy becomes extremely important. And also the way you tackle these more ethical dilemmas, this will be an important one in the long run. So making sure that you don't get distracted by the operational and the numbers alone, but that you keep on putting these things on the table. I think, yes, of course, that's an important role for the entire board, and of course also for the chairman of that board.
Apart from this general guideline in the code on this responsible and ethical leadership, if you move a little bit further down to the code, in towards the code, you see specific responsibilities attributed to the board within this leadership role. Mm-hmm. The main focus there is on selecting and recruiting and evaluating and remunerating the CEO, the executive management. This is really the focus on what is called the leadership role in the board. It's also the most important of one of the most important roles is make sure that you have the right people on board. Do you see there specific points of attentions or trends in best practice on selection on CEO with respect to leadership styles? Mm-hmm. Do you see there evolutions going on?
Well, not necessarily maybe evolutions, but I do think also for a board, all the things we've been discussing so far, it's also important, especially since we see today, and you know this probably better than I do, Abby, I might be completely wrong, but let's say my stereotypical image of boards is that they're still very senior, typically, which may also make, but again, maybe I'm making assumptions that I shouldn't be making, but that they might also have more traditional views of what leadership looks like, what they should be doing. And I think that we also need to make sure that we have sufficient renewal, also, not only in the board, but that at least there is also some challenge from the board to the top management team, because there we also, again, see very senior groups. Typically, again, I might be stereotyping here, so I apologize if that's the case. But so also there, I think boards also might need to let go of this stereotypical image of what a leader should look like, and also there be open to diverse styles and promote this collaborative approach, and not seeing it as a weakness necessarily, that somebody is seeking out collaboration, seeking advice. I think that's exactly the behaviors we would like to see today. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yes, it's already anticipating on the question that we received in the meantime, again from Catherine Delange, who say, do you think that more women coming on board change the way leadership is perceived also by male CEOs?
A very good question. So, and I'm quite passionate about this specific topic, I would say, about diversity overall. So I'll just throw some thoughts on this one. So again, I don't have all the answers on this one. So one thing I do think we need to be careful of is also having stereotypical images about female leaders. In the sense that, and I also see this when we look at this COVID situation, I see a lot of newspapers writing, the countries that were ruled by women, they do better. Let's be a bit careful there as well. It's typically what we expect more from women, that they seek out collaboration. But we also need to make sure that we don't put that as a burden on their shoulders. Oh, you're a woman, so we expect you to be the empathic one and the collaborative one and the one with the people focus. And I think also in a board, we need to be careful of that, that this is not the expectation that we put on this women's shoulders, but that it's actually a responsibility of this entire board. So that's one thing. So let's be careful with that. Now, that said, what I do notice is that because it is something that we stereotypically expect from women, I also notice that when women show these collaborative behaviors, it's also generally more accepted. It also works a bit like a double bind, because we also know that when women then would become more directive, they pay a price for that. They're very often seen as harsh. So in that sense, I can assume, because it is a bit more accepted from them, that it will make a difference. But for me, it's about also more than numbers. And I think the women in this room, but I also see that in many rooms, I would say, if a company or a board only focuses on the numbers and as a way, oh, we checked the box, I can assure you that it's going to end badly, because we know that this is the effect that diversity has. There is no middle ground. Either it accelerates your innovation and you can say, wow, this really paid off, or it can really become a burden and cause a lot of difficulties. And there is no middle ground, and it's not a matter of how long the diversity has been there. It's really a matter of inclusion. In the sense, are we doing something with this diversity around the table? And if it's basically about, okay, I'm glad we checked the box, but now let's move on doing exactly the same as we did before, then I can already assure you it's going to end badly. But if you say, okay, we have this diversity, so this should add something, and let's really also use this diversity that we have in the room, then you can actually see that it has an accelerating effect. But there's no middle ground. And I think if you work on the numbers, it almost automatically requires you to also work on inclusion. And in all honesty, I think it would be naive to think that, oh, we can make the diversity in society go away. So I basically think we only have one option, and that is to make it a success. And that does require inclusion and making sure that we really tap into the potential that this diversity brings, but it will not go automatically. We do need to make an effort to make that work. I feel quite passionate about this one, as you can see.
Yes, I can hear. So if there are other questions from the audience, you see Kathleen is very passionate about many of your questions. So please don't hesitate to send us to us in the chat. Kathleen, next month, we will have our Hoogmis, and I'm not sure how you translate this in English, and our Director's Day, where the main topic will be governance and resilience. But given the fact that we here now discussing leadership, how do you connect leadership and resilience?
Yeah. Well, I think you can, first of all, I think it's important to kind of make a distinction between resilience at the individual level and then what I would call resilience more at the organizational level. So for me, resilience at the organizational level, it's really about how well as a company can you adapt to turbulence? And of course, that really depends to a very, very large extent on whether or not you have a learning climate within your organization. So meaning, is there room for experimenting? Is there room for failing as well? Is there space for reflection? Because if there is no space for that in the current context, then maybe in the short term, yes, it could lead to very nice numbers, but in the long term, we do see that it makes companies weaker, and they pay a price for that in terms of innovation power. So that I would say at the organizational level. But I assume you're also asking this from the perspective of individual resilience, and also, of course, that one is a fundamental one. And I once heard this metaphor, which I really think was spot on, where they said you should compare it a bit with lanes in a highway. And as a leader, you have the lane of your empathy, you have the lane of your financial performance and your task performance, and then you have the lane of innovation and creativity. And in a turbulent context, the pitfall is always to drive on that highway at very, very high speeds. But what you notice is that if you drive on these very, very high speeds on this highway, very often you will only use one of these lanes. And usually that's the lane of financial performance that you end up using. And the first lane that closes down is typically the lane of empathy. And I very much link resilience to empathy, because one of the first signals that you see when resilience is gone with leaders is when they don't feel a lot, because they're so going so fast, they don't feel a lot anymore. And that also, of course, hinders their empathy, which is exactly a skill we need in a turbulent environment, precisely because it brings a lot of anxiety with it. So it requires slowing down, I would say. It requires reflection. But if there's also one thing we know from research, that this is really the thing that almost all leaders hate the most. In the book, we also cite this study that actually showed that leaders, if you give them the choice between giving themselves an electroshock or being alone with their emotions for 30 minutes and reflecting on what is this silent voice telling me, that they actually prefer the electroshock. So we know that from studies that it's something that many leaders struggle with, that is slowing down, this reflection mode. So it does require a conscious effort, but sometimes you need to take really that step back to make bigger leaps forward. By the way, I saw in the chat, I don't know if we can connect also to this, is ethical leadership should also be translated So how to kind of measure that? Of course, it will be measured in a very different way than the typical KPIs. But that said, I also think if we really have a close look at the HR KPIs that are already there, the level of mobility, but also the diversity, if we also take these numbers a bit more seriously and develop a dashboard on them and also have them as an agenda point on board meetings, I do think you can open that discussion much more. And also ethical leadership, again, linking it to these dilemmas, which are directly impacting the business. When you talk about these cars, I do think it's a business question that does require a clear stake. So in that sense, I do think there are metrics, but they're very different, of course, than the metrics that we might all be accustomed with or feel comfortable with. So having also maybe a bit more that expertise on board, in a board, would definitely add value.
Would you, I also read the question, and there is a very provoking part that has not been read, is that would you also go so far that there should be regulation?
And I'm curious what kind of regulation you would refer to them.
It's in the same question. Will taxonomy and other regulation provide concrete solution for this kind of integrated reporting on this non-financial issues that should be taken into account?
I think it's a very difficult one. And if there's one thing I would even say, it's also something I noticed from the board that I'm in, is that it's more, if you look at the code, new code, you also need to kind of understand the spirit of the code and the values behind the code, which is, of course, a bit more difficult to sometimes express in numbers. And I also noticed that the immediate reaction we had was to go and send you emails, Abby, like, what do we do with this? What do we do with that? And I found it very interesting that there is no, very often, not one right answer. But I think that's also what is good about the code, is it puts the debate on the table. And it's, I think as a, when you are on a board, it helps you to say, okay, this is in the code, and to open up the discussion. But then what it will look like, that will of course depend a lot on the business this company is in. But also I do think we need to be careful of seeing it as trade-offs that need to be made. Either we're ethical, but then we lose business. I'm not sure if you've seen the new book by Steven van Bellegem, The Offer You Can't Refuse, which is basically a book about how to reconcile customer expectations with this more, I would call it ethical, call it sustainable, but with this more responsible leadership approach. And I think one of the learnings there is that it's not a trade-off. It's often the companies who succeed in really linking the two who are also the companies who are most competitive. So I think it's good that it creates this openness to just have the debate. But it does require a completely different mindset, because of course you want to conform with the code as much as you can. So I'm curious to hear your opinion on this one, actually.
Well, we actually have an insight, opinion from our audience by Christophe Macour that I like to share on the issue of overregulation, because indeed there is a danger to have a box-ticking approach, and can leadership be regulated? It's about behavior, it's about people. I'm definitely not keen on going into the direction of regulation in this respect. Yeah.
One that I have always liked was my colleague or former colleague, Mark Bulles. He always says, well, you can't decide to be ethical. just like the road to being unethical is a very gradual one. It starts with one slip and then the next one, and then suddenly all of a sudden you end up in this very unethical route. Well, the same is true for ethics. To become ethical, it's not about a 0-1 variable. It's asking yourself as a board, how can we become more ethical? What would be our next step in becoming a more responsible company? And I think that's the kind of debate that the current code really allows for. So I'm actually very pleased that it's not a checking the boxes, but that it really encourages boards to think about what is the next step we could take in doing that. Sorry to interrupt you, Abby. You're muted.
No. Yes, yeah. But I try to be to not disturb your expose, Kathleen, with the background noise. But you're actually right, because and I address to the members also as that you are aware that there were some evolutions going on the level of the European Commission, where there is some trends into making boards more accountable towards sustainable corporate governance, and put it on the shoulders of the directors with possible impacts on the accountability and the duties of directors. So there is a deeply trend going on in this respect with respect to regulation. So Kathleen, her question does not come out of the blue. What is going on the level of a regulation? Mm-hmm. But we have another question, Kathleen, from our colleague Lisbeth de Ridder.
I see. Hi, Lisbeth.
Asking what should be actually the attitude and of the board towards management in times of crisis and relance? And what kind of board leadership is most appropriate?
So I might be a bit biased on this specific question. Should it also include mental health of employees as a KPI? I have to tell you, I'm a psychologist with a PhD in economics. So for me, this is a no-brainer, and it would be yes. But I also see the reality of a board. And I know that it's easy for me to now say yes on this question. But it's not such a straightforward one. But I do think, and in the sense that I listened to a very interesting podcast also on pandemics and crisis leadership. And there the big conclusion was, if you care for employees, employees will care for you. And I think if that is a bit your belief, if you really sincerely believe that, yeah, if we take care of them, they will take care of us, then yeah, automatically this also means you need to be interested in where they are mentally. But that said, I also think we should leave space for difficult emotions in a company, because you also work a lot with HR people, and I do see also sometimes a tendency to overprotect people and to say, oh, it always has to be shiny and happy. Of course, there are contexts or the reality might not always allow for that. So it's about let's say a disengaged engagement, in the sense like you take some distance, you allow for the emotions to be there, you track them, you see where are they, without letting it completely rule you. So manage these emotions. So in that sense, I do think it's important to know that, to also know which are the actions we could take to manage or channel these emotions. But on the other side, I also think as leaders, we need to be mild to ourselves and to say, yeah, well, it would be more troublesome if there wouldn't be no emotions whatsoever. Then I think you have some other problems as a company. So the fact that there are emotions, that there might be some mental health issues, I think it's also a sign of the times. But closing yourself off from all of this, I don't think this is the approach. If there's one thing we know about successful crisis management, it is that empathy is an extremely important one. And closing then yourself off of this reality, I think I always say emotions are data too. So for me, measuring the mental health is just another element of your dashboard, but it should also not be the only one. So you use it as a balanced perspective. Yeah, Catherine, I do recognize that a lot. And it's also, I must say, the topic that we currently see in our Center for Adaptive Organizations, it's this caring, it's easier said than done in a virtual environment where we're basically all of a sudden, all working a bit as freelancers, are working completely independent almost. So I do agree this is a huge challenge that I see. How have I seen companies deal with that? I must say I haven't seen the example yet. But for example, when difficult decisions have to be taken, and I'll be very open with you, also at Vlerick, at a certain moment we had a difficult decision to be take because of course we were hit. We're in education. A lot of our programs are international. So for some parts of our business, I would say we were hit as much as the travel industry. But before immediately making radical decisions, we also asked our people, what do you feel that we should have as a philosophy? Do you feel we should have a solidarity approach? Should we have a very segmented approach to this? So what's your opinion? And so really showing, hey, it's not because we're in a maybe a bit more of a crisis mode that you don't get a voice. So caring, I would say, it's not only about this empathy in the sense like coping with the emotion. I think an important sign that you care is also like, hey, we're still interested in your voice. And when we make a decision, your voice matters. And I think there some consistency also is really important. I saw some companies a year ago, it was all about collaboration, but then they also had to make decisions that were very much against this philosophy. So it's also about staying a bit consistent with the messages you gave before, of course. I know this sounds a bit abstract, but I want to go in there.
No, I was actually already reflecting on what is the debate going on in governance is mm-hmm. aligning the interest, not only mm-hmm. Making sure that your messages are consistent, but also how you, if you say, listen to, giving your employees also a voice, and mm-hmm. is also a part of caring, but it, mm-hmm. I think this is also a debate in governance on the stakeholders more broadly is the inclusiveness of stakeholders in the governance, and this is something this is now top on the agenda, and it's figuring out how you do this from a board mm-hmm. perspective and to align the interest
and maybe also adding to what Catherine says, I think an important sign that we care is that we let people work from home, because in all honesty, it is the national guideline. But I do see in quite some companies some heavy discussions around that. Some companies where actually it would be perfectly possible to keep people working from home, but that suddenly do ask people you should come back. So I would say letting people work from home, it's also a sign that you care, but make that explicit, that it is also a sign that you really, really care about them. And because sometimes we might also just take that for granted, but I don't think you should take it for granted, because I see a lot of companies where this is actually creating a lot of discussions as well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if I may come back to our board, and we already touched upon the diversity, mm-hmm. but the question that I still have is, are our boards well equipped to be fully agile and resilient for the future? Do you see other points apart from the diversity and the inclusive approach?
Well, I do think that also from a board perspective, making this shift to letting go of some of the images we might sometimes have of what a leader should be doing, could be doing, etc., and really think about what is the context right now, what does this context require, and also looking at the expertise around that, because actually we know a lot about what type of behaviors are really needed in a situation like that. So letting go maybe some of our own experiences from the past and really looking, okay, but what is needed right here, right now? And also something I've noticed is still also this idea of leadership can be developed, because I do sometimes see that in a board, we sometimes easily jump to the conclusion, yeah, you have it or you don't have it. So also looking very closely about to the, what are the development initiatives we have? Because if there is one thing that we do know for sure, is all of the talents that are there, they will be redundant 5 years from now. So all we learn today, many of them, we won't be able to use them anymore. The only thing we do know for sure is that we will all need to learn constantly. And so I think as a board, really monitoring, like, is this a learning organization? And is this an organization that really sometimes, and also the people at the top of this organization, do they sometimes dare to reinvent themselves, to be maybe a complete novice again, and monitoring that learning climate? Because I do think that will be an important one, a competitive advantage for the future. And I do think a board can play an important role in that, also by the messages we convey as board members. And if we say, oh, you have it or you don't have it, well, we're not really embracing this learning culture, of course. So we also need to start, I think, with the messages we convey to our top management teams.
And in this respect, what can an individual director take from your good advice and also the different points in your book to develop her or himself to have more impact on that board?
Well, given I think that boards are becoming increasingly diverse, I think I see two splits there. We have younger people coming in with new perspectives. And I think this could also create a dynamic where senior board members go in the pitfall of, oh, we need to coach the new board member and the young board member or new women on the board. And I think that's all fine. But it should also go in the other direction, because there's also a phenomenon we call reverse mentoring, and really also believing we can learn a lot from this new pair of eyes around the table. We can benefit from this new perspective rather than say, yeah, but it's not gonna earn, or yeah, we've done it differently, so let's stick with the old ways. So there, I would say it's basically about being open and being open to maybe a completely new perspective that wasn't there before. And I do think, given that our boards are becoming more diverse, that's an individual contribution that each board member could bring to the table, embracing that diversity.
I think this is very strong and compelling messages that you now are providing to us. There is still time for another question from the audience. Is all your topics or your expectations that you had before joining the meeting? Is anyone else who still has a question for? It's just a unique opportunity to have your questions. I don't see.
Must have been extremely clear or completely off topic. That could also be the.
and conceive, because one of the elements that you also raised in your books was the obligation to stay optimistic, as an individual and also as a board member.
That should have been my lesson for each board member. Optimism is a moral duty. Yeah.
Yes, but you already reflected that, Kathleen, in this contribution. So. Keeping an eye on the time, and as there is no other question from the audience, I would sincerely would like to thank you, Kathleen, to bring your inspiring insight in such a short notice. I've taken away some important key messages on collaborative, empathic leadership, on inclusiveness and diversity, on the learning organization. So there are some keywords, but that stays top of mind. Mm-hmm. I now turn a little bit back to our members, is that please check out the next. There are still two sessions coming up for the Home of Governance Talks. The dates has been sent in our LinkedIn post, and I hope to welcome you again at one of the session, or at least at our director's day. So thank you very much for participating, Kathleen. Thank you once again very much for your time and inspiring insights, and I wish you all the best and a good health for the upcoming days and weeks.
Yeah.